pleased to have you here. My name is Shahabed Azizki. I'm one of the founders of My Micro Invest. I'm not going to speak for a long time because the real heroes of tonight are going to pitch just after me. But I really wanted to welcome you and to thank you to be here. It's now our last session of the year of our online offline events, and we're very, very pleased of how things go on front, because it's well, we run an online business, and it's always a bit frustrating for the entrepreneurs and for the investors not to be able to meet each other. And I think it's very important, because you are here investing in companies, and in behind the companies are a lot of people, and I think it's important that people meet. So this is one of the opportunities to meet the people, and I think it's great that you are all here tonight. I wanted first to see in the audience who's there. So who's already been at one of our online offline events before? Not much. Okay, so I'm going to have to explain to the others what it is all about. In the others, how many investors or potential investors are there? About a quarter, okay. And how many entrepreneurs? And how many are not investors and not entrepreneurs?
Students, there are some students.
In the entrepreneurs, I guess that some of you, or maybe all of you, already had the opportunity to pitch investors or another events. And you all know how difficult it might be, how stressful it sometimes is. And so for the investors of you, well, please also encourage them and help them to pitch, because it's not always easy. They have a very limited time to bring you a message that is very important to them, because it's their business, it's their life. I think it's not only a job, it's really their life. And so in a few minutes they have to convince you that they are doing a great job and they have a fantastic business. So I really ask you to help them to give them a warm welcome and a warm applause after each pitch. One also important thing of these kind of sessions is that it is, well, it's a very close group. You're close to the speakers, so please also interact with them. Please ask questions. You have the opportunity. Sorry?
Do not throw any veg.
I'll try a little bit. But really, please ask all the questions you have after the pitches, but also during the drink after. That's a possibility. But please take this opportunity to do so, because well, sometimes you will learn a lot just by asking those questions. So who of you will ask a question tonight? Who will take the lead to ask a question? Ah, Louise, that's one. All the others will remain silent. Questions? Ah, say hello. So for the investors, Bill, this is a great opportunity for you to find investment opportunities. Please also be serious about it. I think the entrepreneurs are all hoping to be able to develop their business. Before we start with the pitches, we'll welcome Peter De Decker, who's one of our bright minds, and who will present to you, well, a new product that we have. That is, you know, that you all can invest in the startups you want to select. But we also have the opportunity to invest in a diversified set of startups. And that's something that Peter will explain. And after that, we'll go to the three pitches that we have tonight that they will introduce just after Peter's speech. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Charles. So, great opportunity also to introduce my MicroInvest to you. I've seen that there are a lot of new people tonight. Is this working?
No.
Is this working? Yeah, it's better. Okay. So,
okay.
This is better. I hope.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
So, next to Achille Albert said, I'm going to introduce a new product, but next to that, and before, I'm going to walk you through some information on my microinvest, how we work. As you're talking with money, we are talking about investments, it's rather serious, so it's good to have maybe also some more information on what it is actually to invest through my microinvest. This is if you need Wi-Fi access tonight. So, CoStation CD, be more curious. My microinvest team says hello. Chalabert introduced already a little bit the online offline, so we are more than happy to have you here and that you support the entrepreneurs who will pitch tonight. Maybe just first, before going into the products. Sorry. So setting the scene, the why, the how, and the what of my microinvest. Why are we doing what we do? So our why is that we strive to improve our world by empowering entrepreneurs. For us, entrepreneurs are creators of value. They are people who solve problems. And there are people who, thanks to doing that, also create jobs in our economy and will create value as for the society as a whole, not just for the shareholders. We're going to do it without a microphone. And so, by supporting the entrepreneurs, next to just creating the value for a company, we also believe that, and we really strongly believe that they also create value for society, and that by backing the entrepreneurs, we arrive to a society where the economic tissue is rejuvenated in a lot better way. Entrepreneurs, they innovate, and they bring new products, new services to the market. And so, it's really in our DNA to help the entrepreneurs in reaching this by financing them. How do we do that? We do that with an investment platform, which is around crowdfunding. So we are doing equity and lending crowdfunding, which is the financial side of crowdfunding next to donation and rewards. And so investors can, on our platform, invest as of 100 euros. How does it work? So if you invest, do you invest directly in the company? The answer to this question is no. It goes through a financial vehicle, which is called My Microinvest Finance. We do this to lower the administrative burden for the company. Imagine if a startup has in one go, with one crowdfunding campaign, 100 new shareholders. This would be very, very tough for them to manage all these new investors and shareholders. Every time they want to invite these people for a general assembly, or they have to vote on company matters, they would have to send invitations to all of them. So we created a vehicle which is called My Microinvest Finance, and which brings together the whole crowd in one compartment of My Microinvest Finance. And this compartment will act as one shareholder and will invest in the underlying company, so this means the startups which we present tonight. The crowd doesn't receive shares because they stay in My Microinvest Finance, but they receive equity-linked notes. And equity-linked notes is an exact replication of the shares from an economic point of view. So if there is an exit or a dividend paid, then this equity-linked notes will actually take all the economic benefits of this payout to investors, and there will be nothing left in this compartment. So it's really a transparent structure, but it facilitates a lot of the life of the company. What have we achieved so far? We've done 85 campaigns on our platform, or rather 85 companies funded by 40,000 members, and in total investments of 45 million. So we have been around for a couple of years, and these are if you look at the big figures that we have achieved so far. What do we do? So it's all about investing. It's, as I said, equity and lending, but we have a couple of principles that we also always do when we invest. We always co-invest with professionals. So this means that if the crowd invests in a company, that we also want to make sure that after the crowdfunding campaign, there is a professional follow-up of a co-investor who also takes part in the financing round and who can help the entrepreneur in reaching his objectives by supporting him more on a strategic side. So the crowd, this is very difficult for them to help entrepreneurs very closely with their business, with operations, with strategy. Crowd is more there to spread the word. They are really ambassadors, and it's more on the marketing side that they can help. But on strategic side, we think that a co-investor has a lot more value than the crowd. What we also do is that we issue prospectuses. And so in Belgium, there is a law that you can do crowdfunding campaigns up to 300,000 euros without any form of financial documentation or legal documentation. when a company wants to go above that, above the 300,000, then they need to issue a prospectus. And so this is also a service that we offer to startups to raise more than 200,000 euros, but then it's a longer process that we have to do, but it's feasible. We offer the crowd pre-selected investments. This means that we have internally a team of analysts who will screen all the files. So all the incoming files, we will have a look at it. We will see, does this match the quality standards that we want to offer to our investors? And so the team I'm part of, that's our daily job, is to see that the entrepreneurs who come in, that they have a decent financial plan, that on the legal side, everything is covered, and so that when we offer a project on the platform, that we don't have the risk that after 1 or 2 weeks, we actually discover that the project is not viable. So therefore, it's pre-selected, but this doesn't mean, obviously, that the investor, that you don't have to formulate your opinion on a specific project. So if you want to invest, make sure that you also think of the project, of the product or the service, and if there is a market for it. So this is something that we don't judge, but that we let judge the crowd investors. We also manage to own venture capital funds, and this is what I said in the beginning, that we co-invest with professionals, and to drive that, we also have our own funds who invest in companies with specific criteria, and this criteria we find this criteria in the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations. So those are a whole set of criteria actually to solve all the problems in the world. And if an entrepreneur can prove that he is one of these problem-solving companies, then he can get an investment from inventors. So before talking about our new product, I'm first also going to introduce the tech shelter. It's something which is quite important at the moment in startup land, and also I think all three companies tonight, they're all eligible for the startup tech shelter. So what is this? Also here, yeah, so we wrote an ebook which you can download on our website and on the startup tech shelter.be website as well on this tech shelter, because there's quite some information you have to know before you can benefit from it. Also here we're going to set the scene. So the why, this time it's from the government point of view. So why did the government introduce a tech shelter for startups? It's actually because the same reason that we want to support entrepreneurs is that the government also thinks or is aligned with us that entrepreneurs create value in society. And so they want to incentivize people to finance this kind of innovative projects, and so encouraging innovation and entrepreneurship. How do they do that? They do that by facilitating easier access to finance, and so helping entrepreneurs raise capital. And what is the tool they use for it? The concrete tool they use for it is a tax reduction. So the tax shelter is a tax reduction on personal income for private investors under certain conditions. And one of the conditions is also that you invest through a crowdfunding platform. Or I would say crowdfunding is also eligible for tax shelter investing. There are two types of tax reductions. There is a tax reduction of 45%. This means that if you invest 100 euro the year after, so on the year that you receive your tax bill, you can deduct 45 euros of your tax base, of your taxes, if you invest in a microenterprise. A microenterprise is actually almost all startups getting crowdfunding through my microinvest. So these are very really small startups. 30% is for SMEs. Those are companies which have a balance sheet total of more than 250,000, more than 700,000 turnover, and more than 10 employees, and then below the three other conditions that you see over there. So that's a bit a category which is less represented on our platform. We are really financing more these micro enterprises. So there are some other conditions. It's up to 45,000 euros a year. So every investor can invest maximum 100,000 euros in tax shelter projects. It's in the same tax period of the investment. So if you invest in 2017, the tax reduction is for the fiscal year 2017. You must show a proof of investment, which we offer you if you invest through our platform. And the shares must be held for 4 years. There is the word sanction there. It actually just means that if there is, for instance, an exit after 2 years, that the tax advantage will only be on 2 years, so it's on a pro rata basis. Then our new product, I'm going to give you some more information on it because it's quite important to understand what it is and what you want to offer. So we call it a tracer. And you have to think in terms of project versus product. In the past, we always have launched projects on our company, on our platform, where each investor can subscribe to individually. What you want to do is to transform the way investors invest, not on a project basis, but on a product basis. And the product that we want to launch, the tracer, it's around diversification. Because what we have realized is that most investors on our platform invest in around, on average, two projects. And with two projects, there is not enough diversification if one of them goes bankrupt to have a decent return on investment. So we really want to stimulate this diversification. And instead of offering projects, we want to offer a basket of projects. And this is our product, which we call a tracer. So what is a tracer? There is the Larousse or the Vandala definition on the tracer. And we are going to look into it in detail. So don't read this sentence. It's almost impossible to read. But what is important is that it's an automated selection of investment opportunities. So this means that there is a flow of projects coming on our platform. And we're going to define a tracer based on objective selection of criteria. And we'll come back to that later. So if a project is eligible, it will be added to the tracer. And if an investor subscribes to this tracer, he will automatically invest in this project. So it's a hassle-free way of investing in a basket of projects. And we defined that verification is 10 different projects. Tracer has a priority over other investors. So if there is a project eligible for the tracer, we will first allocate the amount of the tracer to that campaign, and then afterwards, if there is still some room, leave this to the other investors. So it is a privileged access with full control. Why full control? Because, as I said, there are 10 investment opportunities that we offer to each investor who subscribes to the tracer. But the investor has, for each project, the option to opt out. So that means if there is a project coming your way, you subscribe to the tracer, but you think for a particular reason that this project is not viable because you know the entrepreneur personally and you think it's not a good guy, or you know very well the market and you think this market is declining, it's not something which where you can make money in the future, you can always opt out. So investors choose a tracer that meets their personal investment needs, and the investor has certainty of a deal flow, so the 10 different projects that we will in 1 year offer in the framework of this tracer. Now, this is a bit how it works. An investor decides to subscribe to a tracer, and just afterwards I will present which tracers we have. There is a new opportunity identified. It will be reserved automatically for investment. The investor has the option to opt out or to accept the investment. If it doesn't opt out, it's just an automatic investment by automatic bank debit. The investment is accepted, and the project is added to the portfolio. And so this will then be repeated 10 times maximum. So we have reflected on which teams that you want to give to the tracers, and we've come up with two of them. The first is a tax shelter tracer. So this means that we will offer for every investor who subscribed to the tracer 10 different tax shelter projects. And so here the criteria is they need to benefit from the 45% tax reduction like the government has specified it. There are some other conditions. For instance, there need to be at least two founders because we think that a team is stronger than just a solo entrepreneur. They need to have invested themselves in the company. And there are a couple of other criteria as well, which you can find on our website. The second tracer is what we call an impact VC tracer. as I presented in the beginning, we have in ventures as venture capital funds also managed by my microinvest, and they invest in impact projects. So these are projects that have a positive impact on society and who try to solve really fundamental problems in our world. And so also here, Inventures is quite active investor. So also here we want to offer this deal flow of Inventures to the crowd investors through this tracer. So there is here also automatic build up of a portfolio of 10 impact investments which will come on the platform. And where you invest together already with the co-investor and professional investor in ventures at the same time. Are there some questions on this tracer? It's maybe a lot of information. We also have some leaflets in the front. Perhaps you already got it. There is also some information on it. On the website there is more information. But if there are any questions right now, I'm happy to take
them. How do you provide liquidity?
Sorry?
What is the liquidity of the tracer?
On the tracer there is no liquidity. So it's actually, there is liquidity, but it's the same liquidity as an investment which is without the tracer. So this means that if you invest in 10 different projects through the tracer, then on an individual basis we will look if there is an exit opportunity and where the entrepreneur will exit, then there will be liquidity. But there is no secondary market where you can either exchange the tracer or the individual project of the tracer.
Entrance and exit fees?
Sorry?
The entrance and exit fees?
Yes.
The tracer?
Chalbert? What is the current, sorry. There is a question on the entrance and exit fees of the tracer.
So there is, the pricing is almost the same as investments in the different opportunities. So you pay a subscription fee if you invest or if you don't decide to opt out on investments, same as on the platform. And on the exits, it's also there is a carried interest, which is exactly the same as on the platform. There's no difference there.
What is the level of carried interest?
Sorry?
What is the level of the carried
interest? Yeah, I'll come back to that, to the levels. And then you have just an entry fee. That is basically, well, for us, the cost of pooling all the investors, etc., and one-time investment fee. So that is basically the sunk cost if someone invests and opts out of every investment, but otherwise it's the same pricing. And so the carried interest on the platform is the same. So it's you have a hurdle rate for those who know what a hurdle rate is. So it's based on an internal rate of return, so it's a capitalized annual return of 5% per year. That is the hurdle rate, and the carried interest is 20% of the capital gain that is exceeding those 5%. In the funds industry, venture capital industry, you have other formulas. Well, it's almost the same percentages, but the formula is normally that it is 20% of the capital gain, and there is what is called a catch-up, which is basically a very tricky thing to calculate or to understand. Okay, the big difference is that in a VC fund, normally it's 20% of everything that is capital gain, and on the platform is 20% of everything that goes above 5% internal rate of return. That's the big difference. If there are more technical questions, so I'm happy to discuss with this. And I'll need a spreadsheet, I think, to hold.
So if there are no more questions, I think that we can go to the real heroes of tonight. So, Fahi, are you going to introduce them?
Okay.
So, thank you very much, Peter. I don't know if the order is still...
Yes.
Yeah. So we have three companies presenting tonight. You see them here, Sizable, WatchMe, and Barnaby. We're going to start with Sizable. Sizable, well, I think you have to be quite quick if you want to invest, because they've done 99.9% of their fundraising, I guess. They have between 5 and 10,000 euros left, which is really not much. Well, they're going to explain what they're doing way better than me, but from my understanding, basically it's for men only, women, sorry, it's not for you, it's for your husbands boyfriends, etc. It is very comfortable underwear that they do for men. Not only comfortable, but also extremely ethical in terms of environment and environmentally friendly, etc. To be honest, I didn't put any on for the moment, but I had the opportunity to touch on just that. I would say the feelings. So I'll let you decide if and when you want to test. We're going to give the floor to Marie Martens, who's going to present Sizable to us, and I thank you very much for your presence.
Thank you very much.
And I think we can give her already a round of applause.
I will start by first giving you some items that I've brought with me, some samples, so you can touch it while I present it. So perhaps in the meantime, Marie, you can play the video.
Yes, so she would.
So, and I'll, in the meantime, I'll send through.
Sizable, of course. Sizable underwear is made of natural fibers whose unequaled absorbing qualities give you that cool, dry feeling. Sizable perfectly matches your size, your body type, and your way of living. We have everything it takes to give you peace of mind, like a perfectly calm, smooth sea.
Okay. So, right, so
Sizable
is Sizable was being created like 2 years ago. I've recently joined the company of being the CEO of the company since September, actually. And Sizable, actually, the name in English means distinguished, notable. And the reason why the founders have given this name is that they saw men, they were bankers, and they saw men on the working floor with the white t-shirt that comes out, or if you're in a meeting, you basically, I could do the Mexican wave and then we can see if there are some sweat patches here. But the fact is that quite a lot of men have those sweat patches and also see through. You can see actually that they're wearing undershirts. And so the idea was actually to make undershirts that are invisible to start with, that are comfortable, and that are very absorbing in terms of sweat. So, and then they went on a tour and tried to find a way as well to make actually textile here in Europe. So that was also one of the criteria in order to be eco-friendly. And so it was all about being responsible actually from manufacturing to cleaning. So that was the purpose. And so both of them are very, very particular with their clothing. And so they were very keen because sometimes they were wearing a certain brand, I'm not going to name them, but after 6 months there was a hole in it and they paid 30 euros for that and stuff like that. So, and basically they really tried to find out, okay, we need high-end quality and we also want to have undershirts that are nice, that are comfortable and also eco-friendly. But then the other thing was that some of you may or may not have experienced this, but sometimes the fitting was not always good. So because some men have a particular shape and then the t-shirt is a bit too short or the shoulders are not well done. So we basically, in that matter, have made sure that all those items were basically taken into consideration. And so these are our products. So we have the undershirts that are going around, the socks and the boxers, and they all have been made with eco-natural fibers. So the undershirt that you've been feeling is actually made out of eucalyptus fiber. So then I'm to the fit that I've really meant before. So if you know, you don't know, but basically men, you guys are not as fortunate as we are women in terms of fitting. We are very lucky. I mean, just if you look at the shops, I mean, women, they have that in terms of space, and men is just like this. And so that's one thing. And also in terms of fitting, it's quite bad because, I mean, there's not much going on, and the fitting has actually been set by the US military. So it's just S, X, well, XS, S, M, XL, and that's it. But there's nothing into fitting. So we basically have determined three body types, which is, in this case, Jim, Jack, Joe. And so the Jims are basically the rectangular guys, so with long torso. And so maybe you have had that the t-shirt is too short or too long or whatever. And so that is just making to make sure that the fitting is quite right. Then we have the Joes. These are more the rounder types, and or the regular guys at some point. And so again, it's just to make sure that the fitting of those undershirts are well, so it will be invisible again under your shirt. And then we have the Jacks. These are more the athletic types, and in this case you can kind of imagine a rugby man or something for that. So this is quite important as well in terms of defining actually what we're trying to do. Okay, sorry, because I think it's in, this is not the right person to communicate it, but okay, never mind. It's just like no, I do. So basically, the market is quite big in bodywear essentials. So we have 41 billion euros in terms of turnover at the moment. And so what we're trying to do, the Belgian underwear market is 130 million euros, and we try to get a piece of it. And so we're going online and offline after those markets. So at the moment, we're focusing actually on the Benelux and on France and the UK for the shops. And online, we're adding on the Nordics as well. And the way we go about it is, so the way we go about it is basically through like SEOs and driving also with ambassadors and bloggers and things like that. And then on the traditional side, we actually pushed a lot on the brick and mortars on the shops, but we now actually, we're trying to reverse that a little bit and just try to choose flagship stores. Because this is a market that is quite in difficulty at the moment because of the e-commerce. And so what we're trying to do is like working, trying to have partnerships with brands like S Adventure. So we have already like a quite good conversation going on there and try to get corners within those shops. So, and the other thing as well, what we're trying to do, and this is also quite, I mean, I'm very happy that this is happening, is trying to go into corporates. So, because maybe you know, you don't know, but JP Morgan, for instance, they have in their conduct that you would have, you need to wear undershirts as a private banker. So this is quite good for us. So it basically means that we can tag on into a Christmas market and basically try to sell our products. So now we have a PricewaterhouseCoopers in Luxembourg next week. We have been invited to do the Christmas market. And so the idea is now to go in within the corporate world because lots of them are on members and benefits platforms and try to tap into those markets as well. And so that is, I mean, these are conversations that are going on. Corporates are not as quick as we are, but we try to get in, and we're already very pleased that PricewaterhouseCoopers, PwC to be sure to say, in Luxembourg have already accepted us. So on the e-commerce front, well, that's just, to be honest, that's just spamming people. That's, but it works. It really, really works. We did Black Friday, and I mean, we had the best day ever so far. So it's really, really good. So what do we need at the moment? We don't need much, as you've heard from Lambert. So in tax shelter level, we have about 10,000 euros left. But at the moment, I mean, the investments that are going to be spent at will be more on the digital marketing and advertising, marketing material, because to build a brand is quite expensive. And so we basically are going to use it for that and also for production to basically finance our production, because like next year, as you know, it's the World Cup, and we have basically a verbal agreement with the brother of one of the Red Devils that we're very proud of, and it's the brother because he's not as expensive as the Red Devil. And so we hope as well that thanks to that, well, that partnership, that we could again raise the visibility of our brand. And I would be very happy actually to see our Red Devils at least wearing one of our boxer shorts. So at the moment we are three. So it's me leading the marketing and sales. We have Franck, who's basically leading our operation and logistics system. And then we have Loïc, who's basically running our e-commerce at the moment. So these are our advisors and our consultants, because even though we're three, but thanks to our network, we're able to count on quite a lot of help. So we have Ines, she's our designer and production person, and she actually works for Inditex full-time, but she also does freelancing. We have Rina Prashar, and so I don't know if you know ASOS, but ASOS is actually the Zalando of the UK, and so she basically is, I mean, has that experience and is helping us with our digital strategy. We have Cécile Robb, and so she is actually senior wholesale market at Polka, and she has 15 years of experience at Burberry, and so she's basically helping us to enter les grands magasins in Paris, like Lafayette, Le Bon Marché, and so on, to get all those buyers. Stéphane Van Bellingen, like you probably know him, is like the weatherman at RTL TV, and so we will be using him next year more in our photo shoots and communications and so forth. We have Jacques Pelkens, who's also is one of our investors, and is actually helping us with our eco-friendly footprint and sustainability strategy. So we basically are living, I mean, are up to date with all the new stuff going on there. And then we have François Rigaud, who's also one of the investors, is also part of our advisory board. And so he used to be the chief marketing officer of Apple Retail. And so he's basically helping us with our branding strategy. So which is, well, he's just been on board since 3 months. So I brought him on board in order to help us for that. And then we have Weeb and Universem. These are basically agencies that we will be working with in order to continue to have a great user experience on our e-commerce and also to drive our digital marketing strategy. So that's it. If you have more information, just please, I'm here, I'm around, so any questions are welcome. And they were not for free, so if I could have
those. Yeah. I see that some of you already thought
thank you.
They could go
home. It's okay, I'm just... any questions?
May I suggest that the other people pitch now, because we have some visitors who are due to leave the room at about 8:15, 8:30. Therefore,
you
we could raise questions
after?
Afterwards.
Yeah. No,
if we could have the other two candidates first.
Just remember your questions.
That's a good exercise.
So, well, next we're going to have Watch Me.
Thank you.
With Sammy.
Hello.
Well, I'll leave him to explain, because otherwise we're going to be a
connection. Good news, it will be very short. it's not my phaser, but I know the product will go very fast to the essence. So we have Watch Me, a startup from Leuven. The company name is Prizorgo, what means caring in Esperanto. So our main focus is in the care sector. And we developed an app which is a personal alarm system, but for smartwatches. So, you know, the traditional personal alarm system, the button that the grandmother has, or something that you carry and you fall and then you can push the button. We automize that with a standard app that runs on a standard platform. So we don't develop our own hardware. and it goes automatically. So the restrictions of the classic portable alarm system, we can skip that. Yeah. So we got an algorithm that detects a fault, and it can be also fine-tuned per person. So the biggest hurdle in fault detection is that everybody is different, everybody got another degree of mobility, shakes or not, sit still all day, drive a car, and those movements we can very easily set per person. This through just a web portal, you log in on the PC and you put the sliders according to your fit. Or if you do something specifically, I got a false alarm with driving, we can filter that out by detecting the thing. But it's automized. So you fall, the alarm generates automatically. If you don't tap, an SMS will arrive at the persons you choose. So the fault is detected. You got on the smartwatch a red button. If you touch it, it cancels it. If you leave it, you will send out an SMS. And in that SMS will be your location with Google Maps. So the persons that you selected will have a fall of grandfather or mother or
doctor.
Kids. And they're there. They're falling in the glass on that corner. You can see that immediately. And you can call them through the watch. We use Android Wear watches with SIM cards or eSIMs. If you call them, they don't have to pick up anything. They don't have to touch anything. They just need to speak. And then you can know what's going on, even if it's a false alarm. False alarm, it generates it automatically. Next step is also to have it voice activated. So you don't have to push on a button, you don't have to fall. If you need help, you just say a keyword, help, help, and the message will go to anybody who needs it. And our prime market are the elderly. We have an aging population, but for the same usage, you can also do it with diabetics from even very young age, when you got a hippo or not. Lone workers, alone in a field, they fall from the ladder. They need just assistance, stuck in a mat or whatever. They can be rescued or request assistance from their colleagues through the wearable. It exists on phones, but you don't have them on you. So if it's on your body, it's always there and you just request help. Our approach is to give it as a service. We provide the hardware, so the watch. For the moment, the Android Wear watch, but as the iWatch of Apple came out with eSIM 2 months ago, we want also to put our software there. It'll be €50. You will receive for that €50 per month a very good smartwatch with our application and access to the portal. So we'll sell it, the full package through website or webshop, but also as a 10 standalone app. The low fruits for us, as we got the app, and the smartwatch is an emerging market. You can think about PDAs in 2005. Your nerdy colleague had a PDA, but the rest of the office didn't. And until the iPhone came, suddenly everybody had a smartphone. But from all the PDAs that were then, none of them remain iPad, Apple Newton, they're all gone. even BlackBerry. We are an app, and we can select our platform. If it's an Android Wear watch, an iWatch, a future new one, we want just to implement our solution on existing hardware, which drops the cost of investment a lot. And to use the app stores of these platforms. That was a message I wanted to give. So if we certify a certain model, we can make it available worldwide for that watch. The only thing that's needed to access those markets is a translation. If we ask your way, your smartwatch 2 LTE, in which country is it sold the most? If they say Korea, we translate it in Korea and make it available to the people that are already existing customers. You can console that on the site of Microinvest. So that's me. My wife. That's my wife. She's our designer. Tom, my partner and co-founder. That's his wife. And our sales guy. I think that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The next one is Barnaby, and Barnaby, and maybe some of you already know them because for the first time they come here. They did fundraising with us some year ago.
Last November 2016.
Yeah. A year and a few days. And so like other startups, basically, they are raising funds for a second time. It can be either bad news or very good news. I think it's good news. Why can it be both? And I think it's important also to know that the startup world is organized like that. It can be bad news because, well, they didn't reach their objectives, they're a bit slow, etc. And maybe all those reasons are also true, even if it's good news. It's only bad news if basically there are new commercial perspectives, and they failed on the basic things of their company, which is, well, the right team in the right market. But a lot of other things can happen in a company. One, it can be all planned from the beginning that they need to raise funds at certain times. It's very often that startups raise funds almost every year or every 2 or 3 years, because you don't want to raise too much in the beginning and nobody is going to trust you if you ask for 10 million for the first day, of course. It is also sometimes because basically you're developing your plan, you're discovering new things, and you say, okay, now I want to go this direction, I need more money for this, etc., etc. So coming back, I think in this case it's good news. I think there is traction coming up, and well, I think you need money to make all that happen. So we'll here to listen to you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Quentin. I'm 26 years old, and I am Barnaby's founder. Thank you for the transition, because first of all, I would like to present the team. So today we are 10, and last year I was alone. So thank you, and it's really, really important at the market, but the team is the most important thing in a project like Barnaby. So what is Barnaby? Barnaby is the best way to connect a new generation of consumer with looking for venues, having a drink, in the best place in town. So we developed two mobile applications. So we have one dedicated to the consumer, available for free on App Store and Play Store if you want to download it today. It's free, only for tonight. And the professional app, it's dedicated to professional. So, Barnaby app for the consumer. So what it is? It's a complete list of venues to have a drink. So we tested all of them, and if you want to join the team, we are hiring, and it's quite a good job to test all these places. Barnaby integrates in his app mobile solution, and some people are telling that Barnaby is the Uber for bars, and is to offer our community a cashless and seamless experience. So you go in the bar, without your wallet, and you can pay directly through the app. Who we target? The millennials, the travelers, young and tourists, ladies, because 73% of our community are women. They are aged between 25 years old and 40 years old. So about the key indicators, today we are staying in Paris mainly, so we validate POC, the proof of concept, and we had 35K downloads, 5,000 people using the app regularly each month, many people on the social network for sure, and since 2 months we have been selected on the Kutker app by Apple Store directly, so we are really proud because it's a thing that you cannot pay for this. You have to work, to innovate, and to offer Apple service, and they select, and we are the only one app in the food and drink category that have been selected since 2 months, so we are really really proud of it. What about the business model of this app? We have an entry fee for the bars, so they have to pay something to be registered, depending on the category, because we are, sorry, our partners are hotel bars, cocktail bars, wine bars, beer bars, coffee shops, tea rooms, rooftops, terrace, and really nice venues like this. And as you understand, we are working and we are focused on the drinking ecosystem. We name it the drink tech after the food tech. We are really focused on this, and we trust in the gain of an app like this one. To continue with the business model, we have a monthly subscription to generate like a scalable product for the and scalable model and revenue for the development of the app. Fee based on each payment through the app. So every time you pay through the app, it's the same price for the consumer, and we take a small fee. We're doing like media content and tailored services. So for example, yesterday we did a professional shooting, in a bar, and we can do a lot of service for them. So considering the application for the professional, so this is Deliver, it's an independent app, also available, but you cannot access to it, you need login. But it's we use a new technology that's called React Native. The same technology we use for Messenger used, and it's a responsive technology, it's a cross-platform technology, so it's available on iTunes and Apple Store and Play Store, so it's really easy for us to not deploy the model, because we can download it directly in the POS system of each partner. This is the mobile order solution, because all the menu is directly digitalized, so you have all the menu, you can check, you can modify, you can welcome your guests, you have all the statistics about the day, so the revenue, all the list of your guests, when you click on the guest, you have his data, so it means that it's a really good tool to fidelize and to personalize the service. Today, so the POC since 1 year is mainly in Paris, as I said, and we have 50 partners that are offering this solution. And the business model is a fee on each customer expenditure, and we are looking for a new model with the white label thing for other type of partner. So the benefits for the user, trusted guide of the best venues in town, so we tested all of them, we have 30 criterias according to the quality of the service, the product, and the venue. So we tested all of them, and regularly we are doing like mystery shopping to maintain the quality of the venues. The geolocation, so directly you can find the nearest place tested by Barnaby team. All the filters and the specific criteria, so if I'm looking for a cheap place to have a beer with a friend, it's not the same thing if I'm looking for a coffee in a professional atmosphere. So we don't have this problem in Belgium, but in Paris, good luck if you want to pay with your bank card under 15 euros. So it's a shame, honestly, for French, and our solution help them, because thanks to Barnaby you can pay from 1 euro. It's 100% secure payment. We had an integrated Stripe system. this is one of the best actors, an American one. For example, Deliveroo is working with Stripe. You can directly split the bill through the app. So you're with a friend and you want to share the bill. So somebody is ordering, paying, and then I just have to check the bill with my friend through the app. You get your invoice directly on the app. For the venues, they grow their visibility for sure, because we have now a nice community of people looking for good venues. They create their income thanks to the cashless facility. You know, when you take a Uber, it's really easy. You just have to click one button and you are going to happen to a B1. It's the same when you are in a bar and you have no wallet, the thing are different. It's saving money and time, precious time, because on one click you can do payment. They have all their database about all the clients directly through their professional tab, so they can check and if they want to penalize, they can get the birthday, for example. So, oh, welcome Julie, it's your birthday, I can give you and offer you a gift. We help them to acquire and adopt the digital best practice and make really simply their customer happier. So about the objective for 2020, we had some KPI. So the first one is to reach 40 and 50 thousand additional monthly active users, to contract with 500 more new venues, to be present in 6 European cities, for sure Brussels, the next one, Antwerpen, and then Lisbon in Portugal, and I hope Lyon in France, and reach 2.5 million, sorry for the mistake, it will be in 2055, I think. But 2.5 million turnover, and should be that close to 1 million. Sorry, but we cannot read it easily. So today we need money between 400 and 800,000 euros. Today, existing business angels and the first campaign have already committed 135k euros. We expect that this campaign will help us to raise 100,000 euros from now. Tech Shelter, as you presented, is taken into consideration for this campaign. And we are in negotiation with 2 big actors. I can't say more, but it's interesting because it's a big, big company. So what we need to find, and I will be quick because we need to have a drink after to talk about this project. We need to hire a chief technical officer. Sorry, today it's Florian, and it's in half freelance and half in associate, and we need it as a chief technical officer, 1 business developer, 1 chief marketing officer, product manager, growth hacker. We need to run commercial offices, because the team is bigger now, to a crime management analysis solution. We have 5 of them, and we need to consolidate all of this, to fidelize our users, and to make it a Barnaby as a reflex in the head. Recent communication and marketing expenditure in order to reduce the cost of customer acquisition, because today it's like around 1.35 euros to get a new user. We need to go below 1 euro. Introduce a new loyalty program with a cashback system, so we fidelize thanks to credit in the app, we can spend in the partners, and start the European expansion, first of all in Belgium. And then, you know what RAB is? No? It's the additional reason to invest in Barnaby. So, hey, it's a book, as I told you. It's, this proof of concept is now established in Paris since 1 year. So we did some of tests in this city, and now we are ready to develop in many cities, I hope, European capital. We have different types of income, so it's quite interesting too. The potential is international for sure. Big players are already seduced by Barnaby. For example, we had a discussion with Avas Media. This is one of the main actors in France about communication. Moët & Cie, this is the Wine & Spirits, a part of LVMH group. We are doing a nice partnership for the beginning of 2018 with Uber. We want to deliver coffee in the Uber to make the service really, really good. Airbnb, we are a mobility project supported by the European Commission. So thank you so much, and just we can put the video to end this presentation.
which is on your profile.
Right.
Yeah.
Ah non, c'est, non, pas cette.
Non.
C'était sur la présentation. Discover, enjoy, and don't ask for the bill anymore. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Do you want to begin with questions? Perhaps?
Yeah, but I'm maybe we're going to do the questions well, randomly. We're going to give a bit of more energy. Before the questions, I think for Barnaby and for Watch Me, for those who don't know, the investment opportunities are still in a private mode, so it's only open for those attending here now today or online. So if you want to invest, if you want to have a look, you need to follow the link that we're going to share on Facebook tonight and tomorrow by email. Okay, so follow that, otherwise you won't find it. For the rest, well, let's maybe start with questions. Please maybe just say to whom you want to direct a question, and we'll ask our entrepreneurs to answer.
I have a question for Marie.
Yeah.
How do you prevent from other clothing companies to copycat?
We can't. I mean, it's we're basically working with radio production houses already is producing for other brands, so we're basically in private label. So the whole point is actually making a strong brand. It's not everything. Our production is made in Europe, so it's made in Portugal and in Latvia. And so all other brands, like in Portugal, for instance, there. These are the undershirts and the boxers are made there, and so we have brands like Replay, like Christian Dior, like Hugo Boss are basically producing there as well. So the great thing about this is that we can order small batches we don't have to commit to big batches, but we also, because of those big brands are ordering huge things and they're very innovative in the fabric and how they use it, because it's all natural fibers, it's eucalyptus, bamboo. They're quite different, and the quality is very high. And so basically their research, we can benefit from that being a small company.
Competition-wise, how do you compare with other active players?
Sure. So basically we have, there are several differences that you have. In the niche part, like only the men body wear, so we have, for instance, Le Slip Français. They're very well known. They also, they're 40 people. They have been backed by private equity fund. I think recently they've raised about 20 million euros. They have 5 million euros now, and they've been existing now for 7 years. Yep. And so this could be in France, but it's very niche because it's only about made in France. So we have the whole eco-friendly story. We have made in Europe, and we have the fitting USP as well, the whole comfort. So it's more universal. Our story is not only made in France, which will only be interested for Francophiles, and that's one thing. Then we have Baligo, so they are Dutch, and so they basically are positioned, and they only do men, and they because Le Cif Français has just launched last year a female, last summer they've launched a female range. So Baligo, it's only men, they're Dutch, also started, they've been around for 3 years, and doing very well, but their market focus is very much the Benelux and Germany. So we don't want to go into Germany just because we don't have the language skills in our team, and because the other markets are equally interesting. Yeah.
Okay. So what is your exit strategy?
That's a question.
Chance
so
the underwear.
So, for us, our thing is that we really want to create a European company. We want to create jobs. And I'm not looking like many startups to basically say like I want to be bought by a huge company. So the exit strategy will be we either be buying just after 5 years, 5 to 7 years, we either be buying back the shares of the investors, or we'll be trying to find like a private equity fund and or a VC fund to basically buy the shares. But the idea is to the idea is really to create a big brand.
The important word in your answer.
Sorry?
Important one is your answer is 5 to 7 years.
Yes.
What Marie didn't tell you is that basically she's recently only
yes.
the CEO of Sizable. So
I've
she arrived 3 months ago.
Exactly.
She's not a CEO of the company, and she bought at that moment part of the shares of the company. So I guess she's there the long run, which means that's probably she will want to buy back the other investors.
I look at the numbers, and since I've been taking over, and I haven't done extraordinary things, it's just basic cleanup and basic communication, and already online the sales have been gone by 10 times, 20, multi, okay? So that's amazing, because you men are amazing. When you love something, you really love. So you buy in bulk. So, and that's the great thing about this product, because it's very basic, it's not a fashion trend, it's really basic. You will always need socks, you will always need boxers and some undershirts. And so, and the products are really good, and they're very comfortable. I even wear them to sleep. So not that it's a criteria, but the fact is, it's amazing to see that I can really tell this one is testing, and at 1 week, 3 weeks, a month after, or when I do a promotion, they buy by 8, by 10, by 8 undershirts or 8 boxers or 8 pair of socks. It's amazing.
Are you talking about bankers buying how many
units? These are just, I hope bankers will be buying it. And I hope, but the fact is, these are just consumers.
Yeah,
these
yeah.
are just consumers. And so that's,
unless, otherwise you subcontract
so
the purchase.
It's so boring to buy this kind of thing.
Yeah, you
so
subcontract
well, that's
your
why
wife.
We'll bring in colors pretty soon. See,
keep it very boring, so you have to buy a lot.
No, but if you see guys like Schiesser, like Calvin Klein, Schiesser, or it's very bland. It's only white, and they only do that. Or Slohi, they only do that, and they are huge. They are humongous in terms of, and they don't have the same story as we have, which is made in Europe, which is eco-friendly, and which is made to fit.
There's another question over there.
As a matter of fact, it makes them buy the underwear on the internet.
Sorry?
As a matter of fact, it makes them buy the underwear on the internet.
Well, actually, just to,
that's
sorry to,
do.
No, but just to add on it, one third of our customers are women. One third of our customers and are women buying for their husbands or
right.
boyfriends.
But then I don't really get your point in German, because the German speaking environment is one third of the European population. So why don't you move to Germany?
Because we have to invest. I know, but we do have to. But first of all, in Germany there's a lot of competition already, and that's one. Two, we have to invest in packaging, because at the moment the packaging is only in English and yeah. And that's a problem for Germans. Yeah, but it's. when I say we're not going to invest, I'm not going to push it in terms of finding stores, finding partnerships in Germany. And the quick wins are really for us France, Benelux, and UK. These are the quick wins. And it's mainly because we have already entries in there. And I'm not saying I'm disregarding Germany at all, but it's just, it's focus. And it's, it's really, it's not easy. And our focus is quite important. But if we have customers out of Germany, but I'm not gonna focus communication at this stage into this market.
Another question over there.
Yes, I do believe you're reselling on Amazon. How much of share on the market? Does
we don't sell on Amazon.
You don't?
No.
Are you planning to?
You've been a bit schizophrenic about that, because if you go on Amazon, then you have a problem with high quality, because that's a brand thing, and so we don't, there is a high-end brand image that we want to give, and we're not sure that's the right vehicle. However, what we're trying to do is basically create partnerships with brands like Suitcase. I don't know if you heard about Suitcase. And so this is a formula that in Belgium at the moment, but they multiply 10 in the Netherlands and also in Germany. So this is a partnership that I'm looking in Germany. But it's basically a subscription formula where you as a man, you basically subscribe to Suitcase and you will get, and you answer your question and you will get basically a suitcase of style. Okay, so you get a box, you don't know what's in there, and so it will be basically a style, a shirt, socks, no, they don't have socks yet, they will come with us, but they will have trousers and a jumper or a jacket, and it's just a box that is, it's a suitcase, right? It's delivered at your house. And so what you will have is basically, you look at it, you say, oh, I like it, I don't like it, you send it back what you don't like. And so our idea, because like Suitcase has started now about 4 years ago, and they've already 10,000 active customers, and they did a partnership with a brand like Paris XL, they've generated 20,000 emails. And so we are looking to those kind of partnerships to basically get our stuff in those boxes and get yourself known.
A question over here.
The question is, how much is the margin of the products, of each product, how much the margin?
Basically the margin is multiplied by 4, 5. So basically, yeah.
To have an idea, what is the price of the...
So our socks are $11.95 for two. The boxes, we have four types of boxes. We have the casual boxers, we have the elegant boxers, we have the long leg boxers, and we have the sports boxers. And they vary between the less expensive one is actually the casual boxer is $19.95. The most expensive one is the sports one, and that's $24.95. And everything is in between, $21.95, $22.95. The undershirts are $39.95.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So, and tonight, if you just put in promo 10, you'll get 10% discount.
It's almost Facebook.
Why don't you cooperate with barbershops?
With what?
Barbershops are mushrooming in the room.
Yes, but, it's not that do we, how can I say it? You have quick dollars with online, and it's just because the problem is with the distribution, it's just very time consuming convincing someone with a brand that is not known yet, and going there, and then they don't really, it's not that cool product. We are an accessory, okay, and it's not really that cool product, and it's really hard to basically try to say, oh, look at my socks, and look at this and that, and this is great, and la 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 la. And I rather think about 5 campaigns that I will do that I know for a fact, if I do one campaign, I have 900 euros ka-ching without paying anyone.
At the end of the story, is it really possible to have two channels?
You have to have two channels. It's not.
Why?
But because there is the experience that is still important. for things. Like, I mean, Le Slip Français, for instance, they just went online and they also now in brick and mortar. So it's just, but the thing is, like, where do you invest at this stage? And where is the focus? And our focus is clearly, like, now more online, although we already are in 20 shops already in Belgium, maybe in Flanders, but we are already, sorry?
I keep with my wife.
You keep what?
I'm not convinced. I keep with my wife. I mean, that's it's to create competition between two channels. At the end of the story,
it's not creating competition. It's at this stage where we
are.
It's not
to answer that, because I don't know for Sizeable, but I've seen a lot of e-commerce verticals that are very specialized that do both, because most of them, well, you need to give a taste to the customers to give them something.
It's true,
but
it's logically yes. But as you said very properly, you want to be focused on something which makes quick money today.
But these, I mean, as I said, I've been in the role for 3 months, but I've no those shops were already there for so
if they come,
it's a good excuse.
And so I've analyzed those numbers, and they're not that quite interesting. But on the other hand, there is IS Adventure, and they only have Tommy Hilfiger as sort. I know for a fact, because one of our investors is part of FNG, which is Fred and Ginger Pantano, SKS Fashion, and et cetera, and he told me that with a corner within AS Adventure, they have 1 on 1 meter, which is not a lot, and they're making 500,000 euros a year. So I think you would like to see that as an investor in my balance sheet. And and these are the type of, I mean, these are the type of companies that I like to work with, and not too much, because I know the hassle, and they will squeeze me out if I go too much in their way. But I still need it to get an authority on the product to the end consumer.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry, I don't want to.
Are there questions maybe also for the other two companies?
So what's the real offer
between 5 and 10,000 euros, so you need to be quick if you're convinced by that.
It's on the website.
It's on the website, that's public. Yep.
For the others?
Yep.
Yes.
Yep. I have a question for Barnaby.
Yeah. Barnaby, yep.
You are focusing on the drink business?
Yes.
And why not on the food business?
Sorry, not on?
On the food business.
Okay, because food business is really competitive, but don't worry, because between 90 and 95% of our partners deliver food. Like hotel bars have snacking menu, wine bars have tapas, cocktail bars also. So
they can sell food?
Exactly, exactly. We integrate, for example, we are working with the Buda Bar Hotel in Paris, one of the 5 stars, and it was one of my first ones, and I enter with my hand 436 products with the cigars, the spirits, and we do it. We develop something in turn to help us, but you can sell caviar, you can sell cigars, you can sell spirits, you can sell experience. We are doing a partnership with an event company working with the wine tasting, and for example, we are selling through the app entrance for those events, so we can sell what we want. But we are focused on the drink tech system because, as you see, it's really competitive.
Okay.
There are a lot of competition on the food tech. Last week I was at the food hotel tech, it was a salon in Paris, and everybody were focused on the restaurant. No, bars need people to grow their visibility and grow their income.
Just
a
practical question. So if I invest still now in December, I can get a tax shelter.
Well, that's a very good question. I believe that you will not close 2017. You're not going to the notary in 2017, but in 2018, or am I wrong?
I hope to close.
You hope to close in 2017.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure anymore.
The whole thing goes before the end of the year.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so it will be eligible for tax shelter in 2017.
For sure.
But
I think that's it's a fair question, and it's of course for a company like us, it's not always easy, because we don't have all the cards in our hands, and so you always have to be a bit careful. I'm not talking about Barnaby in particular, but in general, by the end of the year, well, you must know that there is a risk. And of course, if it's one of your conditions, you can of course say, well, I want my money back. If you say it was for 2017 and not for 2018. But it's nothing to do with bargaining in general. Very hard.
You said you wanted to reduce the price of recruiting customers from 1.35 down to 1.
Yeah.
What are your strategies for doing that?
It's an excellent question. So we are working with a company, it's called Les Causantes. It's a growth hacking company. They have an office here in Brussels. And they develop and they add a really professional tool to understand our acquisition system. For example, Facebook is a really nice, it's not for us, social media, it's a really good way of acquisition because we can target ladies between 32 and 33 years old looking for a nice place to have a drink and stuff like this. And today it's really expensive because Barnaby is the new model has only one here, but when you know the target and you don't have to A/B test everything, it's easily to find the way you have to spend money. And we are beginning to understand how the community react when they are they're good. So we never communicate at noon, for example. We let the restaurant for that. But for 8 in the morning, we can send a push notification. We can send special offers for coffee shops, for tea rooms during the afternoon too, for the moms, for example, on the Wednesday afternoon, and in the evening for sure. We're doing like not spamming, but really precise communication for our partners, and we integrate also a geolocation system. So when you enter in the area of one of our partner, we can send you a notification push. If it's your birthday, you're lucky because you can get €5 to celebrate it, or €50 if you're a good customer, and stuff like this.
And how are you selecting the cities you would like to be? You said you were going to be in 6 cities.
Okay. So for the story, I'm half French, half Belgian. The company headquarters is in Brussels. Paris was an opportunity, so because the market is big, is huge, you have a big offer, big demand. So it was really interesting for us to develop it in Paris. But we don't want Barnaby be like a blog. We are not a blog. I'm not a blogger. I want this model for foreigner, for tourist. And today we want to follow the trend that from Brussels, from Paris, in 1 hour you are in Geneva, you are in Lisbon, you are in London, you are in Paris, you are in all these beautiful cities. You travel really easily, and you are looking to leave the city as a local. For instance, our generation, millennials, and people like this, are renting an Airbnb and not an Ibis for the same budget because they want to feel at home. And we are following this trend and giving them a guide. So working with Airbnb and their competitor is to giving a free guide to all the user. For example, Brussels Airlines contact us because they want a nice place and a nice, they consider Barnaby as a concierge, and to give their travelers a nice place, experience, tested one. So for the choice of the city, Lisbon was an opportunity because, as explained, Maasai Project is an e-conciergerie and they have a pilot there in Lisbon, so it can help us to develop more easily. And Brussels from the earth, because my heritage is here and I want to develop, and I think it's really important, and the market weight digital application like this. You go to Plaza Boniface, Le Châtelain, place like you need offer, you need to live a digital experience in those bars. Antwerpen, because it's really famous, more than Brussels, in the cocktail bars, and they are really, really, really good and innovative. And Lyon, because a guy is following Barnaby since the beginning. His name is Benoît Laplanche. And he launched, and he's on the most, the biggest communication agency in Lyon, and he tried the concept from the beginning. And I always said to him, when we will be ready to develop and to launch abroad, let's do it together. And he's waiting for us here.
Thank you.
Yeah. My last question. What is your percentage of fees on the bar, on the wine bar?
Okay. At the beginning, it was 12%. So it could be big. When you see Uber Eats and Deliveroo, it's between 30 and 35%. It's a bit different because they are not enough, so it's additional revenues. It was at the beginning 12% on every ticket, and now we are doing less because we need the bar. Having this tool as something really useful. So for some of them, for example, we call them les bars d'envoi, so in the bar that at the Bellegarde, for example, the best place. But how long do you wait at the bar in the queue? You're waiting for 20 minutes if you are not very good like me. And this is a problem, and they need a solution like, yes, no, a beer. And it's really critical for them. And for this reason, this kind of bar were really interested in the cashless solution for this is efficiency. We can go to 4%. We need volume, so in this kind of.
There's a question over there. Yeah. How to balance your obligation to your customers, more than the best place to drink, and also your obligation to the restaurant, to the bars that are paying you to get shown. So, for example, the customers don't only go to the top 10 bars.
Okay, so today, as today, you cannot pay to be on the main page. It's based on the localization of you. How we balance for the beginning in the team? So we have Pierre, and he is a business developer focused on the hotelier because for the history called part, the idea came from the hotel bars. People didn't get the reflex to go in a bar to have a drink. Unfortunately, something sad because hoteliers are welcome and we think it's more expensive. We don't have the reflex. Perhaps it's reserved only for the hotel guest, and it's false totally. And the idea of Barnaby came from the hotel bars. So we have Pierre, and he's doing a meeting always with the five-star hotels, the four-star hotels, and boutique hotel. And this category is not the category who is really, really interested in the cashless solution. But they need to be more digital. So we help them on the media, on the content, and on things like this. Then we have Zoe. Zoe is our account manager, and she's in charge of all the, we call them the TCG, It's les salontés, coffee shops, juice bars, really fancy places, like you can have a brunch or a juice in the morning. And she's activated all of them every single day. On the field, so it's like 50-50. It's really important because we need consumers and we need partners. So there is no no important place for them. So 50-50 balance.
It's also typical from for two-sided business models. We have two clients. It's the same for my record. We have two clients. It's always impossible to have a perfect balance between the two. You always have a bit. Too much investors in our case, and not enough entrepreneurs, or the contrary, same for you, and that's why, Quentin, you mentioned growth hacking, which is maybe not known by all of you, but growth hacking is basically trying to go quicker on one side to catch up, and it's partnering is a great idea. Going on to Facebook, because on Facebook you have a lot of info that you can use to try to capture information and to target people. There's also what Sizable is doing a lot. So there's a modern technique of doing marketing. It's trying to go fast and to have a lot of people to reach in one time.
And it's really interesting because we are doing that personalization, and we personalize all the service for the partners. And as nobody is interested in the hotel bars, and not a lot of people know how to talk to them because it's an industry specific one, traditional, there's necessary, it's to acquire that kind of innovation. So it's really passionate. We are in the field because I came from this industry. I'm an hotelier and work in bars. I manage an Italian restaurant in Shanghai, so I know the other side of this job, and this is the reason why Barnaby is well accepted by the market, because we are not like a big actor want to take money on the, this industry. Not at all. So it's really good, and we always want to find advantage in each part. The hotels, the coffee shop, the users, the consumers.
But now, coming back to the point of the balance, I think from a marketing viewpoint, the best is, of course, an equal equilibrium. But from a risk viewpoint, I think it's interesting to see how, within the business, each sector that is providing specific income will move from one period to another. And then this can compensate for a risk if you had only one source of revenues.
Yeah.
Of course. So this theory of balancing is whether you look at it from a marketing or from a risk viewpoint is slightly different. And I think it's a protection for the investor.
It's also, especially in this case, your bars are also bringing customers and vice versa.
Yeah,
absolutely.
It's
absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, other questions? Maybe question for Watch Me?
Yes.
Yep.
I was extremely interested in listening to your presentation.
Thank you.
Because I have personally invested in a competitor located in France. They are not using the watch, the Apple Watch, but they are using the specific telephone set, and this is more dedicated for those who fall down, either because they are old or because they are on a ladder and they are rather clumsy. In France, there is a legal obligation now that to equip your workers in specific field of action with these items. So I think your project with a watch, mentioned also the telephone set, is meant to service a lot of specific fields, and I'm pretty sure that with the your experience of getting rid of the constraints of the alarm systems, there is a broad avenue for you in this specific field, and I wish you all the best, because we are all growing older. We manage less and less the ladders. Sorry about that, but congratulations.
Thank you very much. How was that? Actually, the idea grew from the field forces.
Why don't you
speak a bit louder?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe stand here so that
Sorry.
You can hear you.
Our idea concept grew from field forces. I was pre-sales mobile devices at Proximus, and several customers, corporate customers, who had troubles with their workers, contacted us. And we were looking on the market to address that need, and the French product didn't exist yet, and I was demanding vendors, please, can you implement that to make wearable? And it didn't exist, so my colleague, now associate, said, well, let's do it together because the need is there, and let's also do it for the elderly market and patients that need to be followed. But our telephone cable company, Internet, they got subcontracts with 1,500 technicians on the road daily, and if they're going on a ladder, they have the legal obligation to wear harnesses and this and that, but it's not monitored automatically. Nowadays, there are people running, driving around, watching the people that go on a ladder to see if they got their equipment. Towards the insurance, it could be better if they got their latch on, but also not only reactive. The idea is to make it preventive. If somebody got a fever, they say that you are a worse driver than being drunk, than being feverish. So if a watch can measure your temperature and just call the dispatching and say, please stay home a day, don't infect your colleagues, don't have an accident, and come back to work in 2 days. That's like a new level of prevention and productivity also. Because if somebody do the hardest work, they go work with fever and sweating.
Terrifying.
Yeah, they go for it, and then they are out for a month. So it's better to detect that early and say, guy,
you should take a joint venture so you can know when do you have to change your pen.
Sweat detector.
Any questions for Washington?
Yeah. What is the current market at the moment for you? Do you have already some selling devices, POC, going on?
We get some POCs at elderly care facilities, resting homes, and it's mainly for the wandering behavior of demented people that can stray away. Localization implied, and also the geofence. So if a carrier of the watch would leave his environment, you get a signal, he's out walking. In my village, region, the police force distributes our folders to the people that have this behavior, because in 4 villages, Hoedaert, Vuren, Hulenberg and Overijse, there are 80 people lost each year and the police has to find them. Last month, they spent 19 hours of police men and one helicopter flight to find one elderly person that was gone away. He's very good, he stays at home, but when he sees a plastic bag, something snaps and he go out and pick up trash. He cleans the street, but he keep on walking. And then you don't find them anymore. So they found them 2 days later.
It's the plastic bag.
Yeah. His wife was just ironing for half an hour and he was gone. So it will enable also people to stay home much longer. And for the customers,
another question.
We got also a few prizes, which you can count on for the moment.
How did you come up with the 50 euros per month?
I used to work on hardware as a service products. And a decent smartwatch is very expensive. And the threshold to purchase a watch of 400, 500, 600 euros is very good. So if we can make it in a rental model, everything included, also the SIM card, you get everything as a service with a monthly fee, and it's much more affordable to start. And maybe you don't need it for 2 years. If you say after 2 or 3 months you can stop it because the person isn't with us anymore, you can just say okay.
Okay.
But mainly it's just to make it accessible with a low threshold.
But maybe not for a long term period.
As long as you want, but preferably as long as possible. And if it's a leasing after 2 years, we can upgrade to a much better model.
Mm-hmm.
And stay relevant, otherwise you are quickly blocked with obsolete hardware.
Any more questions? Other questions for the Gumbis, though? All done with the questions, you want to drink. Well, thank you very much for all those questions. It was, I think, really, really interesting. If you want to help those companies, I think there is one very low threshold that you can do. Go to their Facebook page, like them, subscribe to their newsletter. You're going to already help their growth hacking, so that's already good. Do the same with my microinvest, by the way. Well, for those who are interested in investing in those companies, well, you go online,
As I said before, the private link will be available on Facebook and tomorrow via email sent to all of you for Barnaby and Watch Me. And for Sizable, well, it's public now, so please go quickly to it. Like I said, well, it's the last of our online-offline events of 2017. It was a very eventful year for us. We did a lot of things, very interesting. If you want to know more about this year, the number of companies we invested in, etc., well, go and subscribe to our newsletter. We're going to come up in January with a lot of info about all our activities. And stay tuned, because every month in 2018 we'll have again an online offline event. Typically same format, but also some changes that are coming up, and we'll keep you posted on that as well. So thank you again, really, really much. I appreciate it to have you.
And now, let's have a drink.